Leia here from leiaforsci.com, and in this video, we're going to look at the acidity and basicity of alcohols. For the entire alcohol video series, visit my website leiaforsci.com/alcohol. Alcohols are amphiprotic, where amphi tells us it can go two ways, and protic is referring to its proton ability. If a molecule is amphiprotic, it means that it can act as both an acid and a base. In other words, it can be a proton donor or a proton acceptor. For a quick review of Arrhenius, Bronsted, Lowry, and Lewis acids and bases, study the tutorial linked below. Let's take a look at a simple alcohol, ethanol. If the alcohol picks up a proton, we get a protonated oxygen with a positive charge, where the alcohol that picks up the proton is a base, and the protonated alcohol, or the oxonium, is the conjugate acid. If the acid reacts to give up a proton, the resulting molecule is an oxygen with three lone pairs and a negative charge and a proton in solution or attached to another base. The resulting molecule is an alcohol with three lone pairs as a negative charge. The alcohol that gives up the proton is our acid, and the resulting negative alkoxide is our conjugate base. Which reaction is preferred? Remember that molecules, just like anything else, if they're happy, they're stable, unreactive, and therefore more likely to form. If we look at the oxonium, it's relatively stable, but the alkoxide, you should remember from your substitution elimination reactions, is very strong and very reactive. It is not very stable. This tells us that equilibrium lies to the right for the acidic reaction and lies to the left for the basic reaction. Why is that? The pKa of an alcohol like ethanol is 15.9. Remember from general chemistry that when you have a high Ka or a low pKa, that gives you a very strong acid. In the case of 15.9, this is a relatively high pKa and therefore a relatively weak acid. Compare that to something like ethanoic acid. Ethanoic acid has a pKa of 4.8, where every pKa unit is a tenfold increase in acidity. Let's look at acidic alcohols in more detail. When alcohol picks up a proton, the resulting positive oxygen is called an oxonium. This is something that you'll see a lot in reactions, or rather, this is something that will be implied in a lot of organic chemistry reactions. For example, think of the SN1 reaction in which you're given an alkyl halide reacting with sulfuric acid in a methanol solution. Anytime you see sulfuric acid, understand that it's an acid catalyst that donates an H+ in solution where we don't care about the resulting conjugate base. But what happens next? What does methanol actually do to this reaction? Not only does it act as the solvent, but this is a solvolysis reaction. When sulfuric acid dissolves in solution, the protons don't just randomly float around in solution, they get picked up by the solvent molecule, in this case the methanol, where the reaction looks something like this. The H2SO4 is going to react with the methanol solvent molecule to give us HSO4- as a conjugate base that does nothing, plus the protonated methanol, which is holding on to that proton that came off in solution. Looking at this reaction carefully, you'll recognize that this is an acid-base reaction. Sulfuric acid forms HSO4-, which is the conjugate base, and methanol, because it reacts with the acid to pick up a proton, is the base, which forms the protonated conjugate acid. Alcohols will easily be deprotonated to form the conjugate acid, but they're less easily deprotonated to form a conjugate base. This is because a weak acid is going to form a stronger conjugate base, and if given the opportunity, the strong conjugate base will seek out a proton in an attempt to reform the weaker and more stable acid. There are two common reactions to form the alkoxide anion. The first is to react the alcohol with a very strong base in a way that does not allow equilibrium to shift back to the left. For example, using NaH or sodium hydride, recognize that sodium is a spectator and hydride is a very strong negative base. The hydride grabs the hydrogen off of the oxygen, giving oxygen back its electrons, forming the alkoxide, where oxygen now has three lone pairs and a negative charge, and the hydride attacker is now bound to the alcohol's hydrogen to form H2 gas. This is what makes the reaction irreversible, because H2 as the gas bubbles out of solution, and if you try to reverse this reaction, they're nowhere to be found. Another reaction you'll see is reacting alcohol with a neutral metal like sodium. Even though the two reactions look very similar, they're actually very, very different. In the case of sodium hydride, sodium is simply a positive spectator. It's there to balance charge and nothing else. It's not reactive. In the case of sodium metal, we're dealing with a neutral sodium atom, which if you look on the periodic table, you'll see that it's in group 1, which means it has one valence electron. This gives us a very reactive sodium for a radical reaction. Most of you are not required to know this mechanism, just to understand what is happening. Sodium donates its one electron to the hydrogen atom so that the two electrons binding oxygen to hydrogen remain with the hydrogen. This once again gives us an oxygen atom with three lone pairs and a negative charge. This reaction will also form H2 gas to bubble out of solution. How? We have to use everything twice. If we start with two alcohols, two sodium atoms, then we have two hydrogen atoms each getting one radical electron, which gives us the two electrons to create that H2 gas bond for a very different reaction with a very similar outcome. A deprotonated alcohol is called an alkoxide, where the alk portion refers to the alkyl chain, and oxide is the negative oxygen. Some common alkoxides to recognize are methoxide, which is just a methyl group, ethoxide, has an ethyl group, and tert butoxide or tert butyl oxide, which you'll often hear me refer to as the chicken foot base. You should recognize these from your substitution and elimination reactions, where methoxide and ethoxide are both very strong nucleophiles and very strong bases, and the tert butoxide, as a big bulky base, will go for the E2 reaction, but the non-Zaitsev or Hoffman product. For a detailed review, see the substitution elimination series link below. When it comes to ranking the strength of acids and bases, some professors will provide a pKa table and most will not. Does this mean you have to memorize pKa values? No. Instead, this means you have to understand the basic karyo principles that I teach in the acid-base series link below to help you rank the molecules based on what you see rather than based on a number that you memorized. As a reminder, karyo stands for charge of the atom that we're comparing, resonance stabilization of the atom, induction or the inductive effect, and orbital hybridization, specifically of the acidic or basic atom. Let's do a quick review as it relates to alcohols, starting with charge. Charge is pretty straightforward, because you should remember that something more positive tends to be more acidic, and more negative tends to be more basic. If everything about the two molecules in question looks the same, where the only difference is the charge, we look for the more positive to be the more acidic one, and the more negative to be the more basic. For atom, if we're comparing two alcohols, the atom is going to be the same, an oxygen. But what if we're comparing an alcohol to something else? I ask you to memorize the following 10 atoms on the periodic table: hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, bromine, and iodine. This helps you remember that electronegativity increases up to the right and size down to the left. What if I take these three atoms and put them on a carbon chain? For example, if I have CH3 bound to a carbon, nitrogen, or oxygen. Oxygen should have four bonds, so we'll give it three hydrogen atoms. Nitrogen should have three for two hydrogen atoms, oxygen two bonds for one hydrogen atom. Let's rank them in terms of most to least acidic. What we're looking at here is an atom holding the acidic hydrogen, where carbon is the least electronegative and oxygen is the most electronegative. Electronegativity tells us how strongly the atom wants to be negative, or rather, how stable the atom will be with that negative charge. If you're looking at these three neutral atoms and thinking, I can't compare them, sometimes it's easier to look at the charged molecule, so ask yourself, what happens if I remove an H+ from each molecule? In each case, losing a hydrogen gave the atom an extra lone pair of electrons with a negative charge. Looking at the electronegativity, carbon, being least electronegative, is most unhappy and therefore most unstable with that negative charge. And if it's very unstable, it's going to be highly reactive, making it less likely to form and most likely to return to its neutral state. If the molecule does not want to form a base, that makes it a very weak acid. Nitrogen, of intermediate electronegativity, is in the middle, so it's not happy with that negative charge, but not as unhappy as the carbon. That puts it in the middle. And oxygen, as the most electronegative atom, is most comfortable holding on to that negative charge. So even though it's still very strong and very reactive, it's a lot more stable than negative carbon or nitrogen, making it the least reactive of all three and the most likely to remain with that negative charge. If it's most likely to keep the negative charge, it's most likely to react in a way that makes it give up the proton to form that negative charge, making it the strongest acid in the series. If we look at the pKa values, an alkane has a pKa of 45 to 50, the amine has a pKa of 35 to 40, and alcohols have a pKa between 15 and 19. But we didn't solve it using pKa, we solved it by understanding. And this is where it gets interesting. For resonance, we're not just looking at the atom and its charge, we're looking at what's going on nearby. Let's take a look at ethanol once more and compare it to a molecule that is very similar, except for the fact that there is a pi bond sitting on the carbon that is holding the oxygen atom. You should recognize this molecule as an enol because it has an alkene and an alcohol on the same carbon atom. Recognize that the oxygen can resonate its lone pair of electron onto the carbon atom, kicking the pi bond over to the left. We'll show the resonance over here. With a lone pair and negative charge on the left carbon, and a pi bond between the oxygen and right carbon. Oxygen now has three bonds, one lone pair, and a positive charge. Based on this resonance, which molecule is more acidic? It's hard to tell. They're both neutral, so let's look at the conjugate base. Removing a proton from ethanol gives us ethoxide. Removing a proton from the enol gives us an enolate. This is where we can see the difference. The ethoxide oxygen is stuck holding that burden of negativity by itself. But the enolate, which is a deprotonated enol, can share that negative charge between oxygen and the nearby carbon atom. If oxygen is not left carrying that negative charge by itself, it's more stable than the ethoxide, and if it's more stable, it's more likely to form, making the enol the stronger acid. Anytime we say that something is a stronger acid, the conjugate base of the weaker acid is going to be the stronger base. If the enol is the stronger acid, ethoxide becomes the stronger base. The inductive effect takes a look at what else is going on the molecule. Once again, we're comparing two molecules of ethanol, but the second ethanol has a chlorine atom on the carbon that is holding the oxygen. How does that chlorine atom impact the acidity? We know that chlorine is a halogen, and halogens are highly electronegative, but they're not just electronegative, they're greedy. Chlorine starts to pull on the electrons between itself and carbon, making the chlorine partially negative and the carbon partially positive. If the oxygen is sitting next to a partially positive carbon, its electron density starts to be pulled towards that carbon atom, which doesn't look like much in the neutral molecule, but look what happens when we deprotonate. The products look exactly the same, except for chlorine sitting on the second molecule. But if the electron density is being pulled from the oxygen towards the carbon, that means that even though oxygen isn't getting any real help, meaning there's no resonance to help it carry that negative charge, having some of its negativity, some of its burden, pulled in the direction of carbon makes the oxygen less burdened or less overwhelmed with that negative charge, and therefore makes it more stable. If this conjugate base is more stable, that means it's more likely to form, making chloroethanol more acidic. Whereas the ethanol that just forms ethoxide is less likely to form, making the ethoxide more basic. If you look up the pKa values, you'll see that ethanol has a pKa of about 16, whereas chloroethanol has a pKa of about 14, meaning the acid is almost 100 times stronger than ethanol. Last but not least is the hybridization, or orbital hybridization, of the atom. Orbital hybridization is less likely to come up during the topic of alcohols. One specific alcohol that we do want to look at in more detail is the phenol, and specifically how resonance impacts the acidity, which is exactly what we're going to cover in the next video. First, make sure you give this video a YouTube thumbs up, and then visit layoffrecy.com/alcohol for the complete alcohol video series along with a practice quiz and cheat sheet.